What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Stay True Sunday Podcast.
You got your girl Kelly Jean.
It's at Cozy in the House.
And I'm Lucky Lou, and we got a special guest today, Mr. Pastor Juan.
What's going on, man? Yo, I hear y'all name, and all of a sudden, I kind of want to come up with a name, too. I don't know, so maybe by the end of the show, we can come up with something.
Oh, we were just getting crunk because Lucky just basically informed Pastor Juan and myself, because I didn't even know that it is our 7th episode. And I don't know if y'all remember, but a couple episodes back, we were talking about the seven episode curse.
Yeah.
Dang. Yeah. Hey, you know Lucky's smart, because he's like, yo, 7 episodes, just in case, bring in the basket. So we can get to the 8th. So we can get to that 8th.
We need them good vibes.
So we made it. We made it. We didn't give up. We got all the way to the 7th episode, and now we're just pushing to keep it going. And
yeah, we try to do it every Sunday, and we can't make it every Sunday, but we appreciate y'all, because when we don't make it, y'all be right there asking us where the podcast at, and that's why we keep it going for y'all.
Y'all be harassing us.
Yeah, I remember, in that episode, I think it was like episode 2, maybe we were talking about the 7 episode curse.
Yeah.
And we had, I had brought that up, and Lucky was like, 7 episodes? We'll be 7 episodes by December.
Yeah,
that was here we are. Here we are, it's March 1st.
How long ago was that?
That was like probably in,
I think we started in December. Yeah.
Nah, we started a little before that.
It might have been. Yeah. Probably November. Yeah, it's been about 3 or 4 months. It took us
so you made it. You're like, it wasn't a 7th episode. It was like a 3rd, 4th episode.
It took a little longer than expected, but we got it done.
Yeah.
That's what's up.
So, like we say, we have Pastor Juan today as our special guest, he is a pastor, but we're going to let him talk a little bit about himself. So, Pastor, tell us what's up with you, what you got going on, and then we'll get into your story on how you became a pastor.
What I got going on right now?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm a pastor of a church in Spring, Texas, and so I pastor there. We're launching a campus in Southeast, and then we got a campus in New London, Connecticut. And so I just traveled around sharing the good news, right? Everybody needs some good news, you know what I'm saying? And so I tell people good news, that's all.
Yeah. Okay, so me and Pastor Juan met the other day, and we went to go have lunch. And he was telling me his story on the way to go. On the way to lunch. Let me back up and tell you what's been going on with me. So, as y'all know, I've been trying to do the right thing to start this year. I've been praying every morning, you know what I'm saying? I've been asking God for help. I just can't do it on my own. I need God to help me, you know what I'm saying, and walk with me. And I've been trying to do the right thing. I have been doing the right thing, but as I've been trying to do this right thing, things in my life have been, going wrong. I've been having a lot of bumps in the road and just bad things have been happening. For instance, today when I got out of church, I found out that my website got hacked. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, they're trying to get you.
trying to get me, man. You know what I'm saying? Someone texted me that, like, hey, your website's down. And I went to it, and it's somebody, my homepage, it takes them somewhere else, and I got to figure it out. Hopefully this week I'll get it back up. But right now my website's hacked. So stuff like that's been happening. On my way to go meet with Pastor Juan, I had a blowout, 2 flat tires, busted 2 flat tires, and I didn't think I was going to make it to the meeting, so I called him to let him know what was going on, and he said, don't worry about it, I'll come over and I'll come help you. So he picked me up, and we went to lunch, and then on the way to lunch, I asked him, how did you become a pastor, and how did you get into, church, and then, because some people just grow up in the church and become, pastors, but his story wasn't like that. So I was like, oh, that's a great story. I need to get you on the podcast so you can share that story.
Here we are. It's funny too, because sometimes, I'm glad that my identity is in Christ and not in the people's opinions. Because immediately when you posted the picture, right? Nobody's in the room. Nobody knows our conversation. Nobody knows nothing. We had our own private conversation and we talked. And we had a great conversation, right? We weren't puffing L's or we weren't turning up and drinking. We were turning up in our own way, in a positive way, right?
Yeah.
And immediately people just start, ta 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 ta. I can see the comments. Some are excited and some are already like, oh, Pastor Juan, I'm like, dude, it trips me out. That's why people don't want Jesus. It's not Jesus. It's the people that represent him, you know? Yeah. That kind of sucks.
Yeah.
You know? And so, yeah, man, the story was wild, you know, when I thought the same thing, you know, when you had the two busted ties and all that. And I was like, man, this is crazy. I said, nope, the devil doesn't want this meeting to happen.
Yeah,
you know?
Man.
And, you know, in the podcast, you call me Juan, man. We good. Oh, really? You know what I'm saying? I don't know. I don't want a title trip, you know?
Yeah.
And I just feel like for me, it wasn't like that. I didn't come up like, you're gonna be this pastor, you know? It was like the polar opposite, right? Yeah. Like, I sold drugs for 23 years. Like, I was telling you in the car, my whole back is tatted, my legs tatted, my arms are tatted, my chest is tatted, you know?
Yeah.
And I go like, now you can't see it though by just looking at me, you know?
Yeah.
But my past is, I sold drugs for 23 years. And I wound up coming to Texas because, I saw enough movies. It's like I saw Coast over there. I saw him in that picture frame over there. I said, Coast an actor? You know, so I come out here because I saw enough movies and I was like, yo, look at all these movies. And for some reason, I was like, I don't want to be the middleman.
Yeah.
You know? And so, yeah,
I mean,
it's true. Yeah, I'm like, I need this, the real thing. I need to be in one of those movies, you know? So I jumped on a Greyhound. My mother told me, where you going? I said, Texas. So I sold some drugs, made some money, took a couple packs with me, put it in a backpack, got on a Greyhound, and went to McAllen, Texas.
Yeah.
Right outside of Mexico. Yeah, man. And before you know it, man, I went outside, there was two chicks there. You know, the devil got a plan for you, too.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You just got to be smart enough not to fall for it. But this time, I wasn't smart. I fell for it.
Right.
You know, so these two chicks were like, yo, we're going to Mexico, you know? Yeah. And I'm thinking, bet.
Yeah.
So two reasons, right? The chicks and Mexico, right? Yeah. And so I go over there. Oh, because I was smoking a blunt outside. And they were like, what you doing? And I said, I'm smoking. And they're like, you don't do that here in Texas. You get arrested. I said, in New York, we smoke in the bus stop.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it's like normal.
Yeah.
Over here, she said, you can go to jail. Yeah. So I'm like, so I put it out. I went with the two chicks into Mexico.
Yeah.
And started drinking shots, all this stuff. You know, before you know it, I meet this one guy, right? And I asked that one guy, like, yo, you know, you're getting cocaine, perico, you know? And so the dude tells me, yeah, he comes back. I give him $20. He comes back with something that was like, I thought it was fake. You know, I'm like, this can't be real. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm telling him, like, wait right here. So I go in the bathroom. I taste it a little bit. And I'm like, oh, man.
Yeah.
I said, this is real. So I go out there. I'm like, whoa, I'm blown away. You know, one thing leads to another. I meet the, like, number 9 cartel at that time, the nephew.
Yeah.
He owns strip clubs in Donna, Texas and all this stuff, you know? And before you know it, man, I'm in, you know, and all stuff is kind of, you know, I'm going to give you the short version, right? But all this stuff is happening, and I wound up getting extradited on this bus, like you see, like Con Air, you know? And so they move you around, 18 days moving me around all these different facilities to get me back to New Jersey. And while I'm in that bus, this guy that I sit next to, you know, because you shackled right next to him, you gotta like learn how to eat fries, right? You know, like with rhythm.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And so, because you got you all chained up, so you're like, you eat a fry, you take a bite. And you get real good at that stuff. But the crazy part is that he tells me 506 West 6th Street, Breckenridge, Texas, 76424. I still remember the address of today, right? So for 18 days, I was like, 506 West 6th Street, Breckenridge, Texas, 76424. And people would be like, yo, New York. I said, shut up.
Yeah.
Shut up. 506 West 6th Street. You know, because money had my heart, man. Yeah. It was crazy.
What was the address?
It was an address to a house that he was going to meet me at when I got out, when we both got out. Mm. So he's like, when you get to where you're going, write a letter so we can connect.
Yeah.
Because I was going to make the most. That's how the enemy be too. He like, you're going to make the most money.
Yeah.
And so I was like, that was like God to me. If money told me, anything that told me money, I will move to it.
Yeah.
And I will gravitate to it. You know, not knowing, like, I'm going to throw a little Bible verse in there. Not knowing that he says to seek the kingdom and he gives you everything else. What we do is we seek the everything else.
Yeah.
And so we do it backwards. And then we want to see God when we're in trouble.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right? You know, like a genie, like Aladdin. And so at this moment, man, I'm rolling and I'm 506 West 6th Street. Now, I wind up 18 days later getting to New Jersey. I got a big old beard. I look like Fidel Castro. I run inside. I'm like, somebody give me a pen. They throw a pen at me. All right, 506 West 6th Street, Breckenridge, Texas, 76424. And then I'm like, you know, think about it. 18 days, yo, that's some serious stuff, bro.
Yeah.
18 days, bro. Yeah. I mean, all you're saying is that I will go to sleep. 506 West 6th Street. Wake up, 506 West 6th Street. You know, we're talking like, because I really wanted to get this money, you know?
Yeah.
I get out, I start writing, I get out, the dude gets locked up in Ohio, he gets transferred to Ohio, so I never see him. I'm on my way to Florida to make this big deal, because I figured I know this guy, I'm gonna buy it over here for $9,000. I'm gonna sell it to this guy. I was gonna make about 20-something thousand in one shot.
Yeah.
Then I was gonna come back and I'm off to the races, right? You know, I had it all calculated. Well, I never make it to Florida. I stop in Breckenridge, Texas, and they introduce me to meth.
Yeah.
And so that, you know, this girl, she's like, oh. I said, well, you're going to give me weed? She's like, I can't. She's like, I can get you meth. And I'm like, what's that? Because up north, there's heroin, cocaine, and marijuana. You know, all of a sudden, this lady's like, meth. So I try it, and I'm up for like 3 days. And I'm like, yo, I'm up for 3 days. And I'm telling her, like, this ain't doing nothing.
Yeah. I just can't sleep.
Yeah. I just can't sleep. But I don't feel nothing, you know? Yeah. And so one thing to another, since I had the hustle mentality, before you know it, man, I went on this ride that realistically I didn't want to get on.
Yeah.
Because we all know deep inside our hearts, we do things according to our environment and what we learn or what we feel pressured to do. But deep inside, when you're alone, you don't really want to do that, man. You want to... I saw a video the other day where you were talking to people about getting out and how people hate because you're not in doing those things. Because you want to be a family man and you want certain things
to have in life.
Yeah, you want to better your life. So you want to be able to do them legitimately. Like, it's great right now that, you know, I share my story when I go to places and I go, look, y'all don't understand because they only see Pastor Juan. I go, look, when I had a license and I was legal, yo, I was celebrating from pulpits all over America. I'm like, yo, I got a license. And people are looking at me like, why is this dude so happy? I'm like, you don't understand.
Yeah.
My whole life was crooked.
Yeah.
I never got a place under my own name. I never had a real legit license. I never had a real legit insurance. I never had real legit bank accounts. Never nothing legit.
Yeah.
But yet in the streets, we're like, keep it real. Man, ain't nobody keeping it real out there. They're all keeping it. They ain't keeping it 100 the way we really want to.
Yeah.
And so with all that being said, man, I wind up taking over all of 30 and 20 from Mesquite, Texas, all the way to Odessa, all the meth in between all the little towns. You know, I still got heroin, see the little needle marks?
Yeah.
All that stuff. So the reality, it took me a lot further. Man, to me, I never had a problem. It was always a party. Yeah. I used to look at everybody else like
that.
That's
how I saw it too. I was just partying. I didn't realize I had a drug problem. It, to me, I was just partying.
Yeah, fact. Because you think like, y'all have the problem. Look at me. I'm still good. It's always,
I got money.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I got money.
Bro, I was smart.
Because you think dope fiends don't got money. If I'm a drug addict, I wouldn't have no money.
Okay, let's stop reminiscing.
That's the truth though. Like, I would look in the mirror. I seen this picture. I'm gonna show you this picture here in a minute. But I, you know, actually, it's coming out in the book, so I don't want to, like, you know, put it out there. But this, I have this picture of me when I was like tripping, right? And I look at it, and when y'all see this picture, you're gonna be like, "What? Look at that picture right there."
Yeah.
Yeah, it don't even look like you.
Oh, yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
So, busted down.
Hey, but let me tell you something. I had name brand clothes in a pocket full of money and cars and safe houses. So when I looked in the mirror, now I'm like, yo, no wonder people were like, you're dying.
Yeah.
But to me, I would look in the mirror and I thought I was hot.
Yeah.
Crazy, right? I thought I looked good, man. Yeah. Nobody could. I was blind. I was blinded to myself. As long as I had that money and that car had the TVs and the butterfly doors, I thought,
I'm
the man.
Yeah.
You know, and it always led me to places like I wasn't in my kid's life. I ruined every relationship because of it. Like nothing was good, you know what I'm saying? But I never planned, you know, even now I feel weird when they're like, Pastor Juan or this, and you know, you keep growing churches and they're like bishop and all this stuff, you know, and I'm like, I get it and I understand why people call you this, you know, of course it's a biblical thing.
Yeah.
But the reality, man, I'm just a man that was blind and I could see.
Mm-hmm.
I was a man that couldn't walk and not could walk. And how could I not tell people about this encounter that I had? You with me? Like, it'd be impossible. Like, why wouldn't I share that? Like, why wouldn't I be the Moses of the people and go back to my people and tell them, like, yo, you don't have to live like that, like a slave. You don't have to do that.
Yeah.
You need to wake up. Like, that's what we have. I feel like that's what we have to do.
Yeah.
But so tell the people that are listening right now, what was the day that you realized God was real? Like, that God came into your life and was like, hey, I'm here. I'm here to save you. You know what I'm saying? Like,
you know, it's crazy. Like, I always thought God was, like, far, far away in that. Every time I like talk to God, which kind of was like not really talking to God, because I used to Our Father who art in heaven, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I never thought like God was like within me, and I never really read the word, none of that, you know. So I was in, it was in prison, and so to this day my wife says, you know, my baby Ruth, shout out to baby Ruth, you know.
Hey.
So, you know, I gotta give that, I love my wife, man. She's everything. Like, she, when I got out, I tell her sometimes, like, girl, why you got with me? Because I was busted, bro. I had the thrift store clothing, you know, everything was oversized. Yeah. You with me? I had no money, I had nothing. And yeah, she looked at me and she was like, oh, I love you. And I'm like, in my head, I think, like, girl, I wouldn't have got with me. Like, you know what I'm saying? I do, man. I'm like, man, you must have saw something a lot greater,
yeah,
than what on the outside. You with me? And so that's why I love my baby girl, because I feel like she was with me when
you were down.
When I was down, 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 yeah, down, bro. When I'm telling you, like, I didn't have two coins to. I remember crying out to God and saying, like, man, God, I can't even buy her tea. You know, like, I was humbled. You know? I was like, I can't even go buy her a glass of tea. Like, yeah, I couldn't get a job. I had the X on my back. I was a felon, all this stuff. But the moment is when I was in jail, and where was I? I was in Mineral Wells. No, I was in Weatherford, Texas. You know, I've gotten kicked out of all those small towns, like in the movies, like Billy the Kid. They're, yeah, like, New York, you're going to get out of this town.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, yeah, it's crazy. Oh, and you come back, I'm throwing the keys, yeah, away. You know, that type of thing. I'm like, yo, I used to feel crazy. But they in that town, I was locked up, and I met this guy who told me he was there for me. And I was like, ah, you there for me, right? I'm thinking, like, you got a crime, too. Like, stop it, you know? And while we're in there, you know, the next morning, I didn't really pay attention because I was like, whatever. You're like, yeah, you got something, like, right? And so I look, and he's across. He's on the other side of this facility. It was the top floor that we were on. You know, God, I don't know. He has a funny sense of humor. I was all with all the Aryan Brotherhood. I was the only Hispanic in the thing. I should have died then. And I still made it through that, you know? And so that was my lion's den. And so I look at the guy, and he's like, laid down on the ground. You know what I'm saying? And I'm waiting for him, and the dude don't move.
Yeah.
So I'm like waiting. So I go work out. I come upstairs. He ain't move yet. I go take a shower. He ain't move yet. You know, I grab my little suit, bust him on the floor. You know what I'm saying? Put a little thing, a little tuna pack in it. You, yeah, know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Right? Wham. I start eating. I start eating. He's like, yo, just made one. Like, yo, I start eating all this stuff. He ain't move. When I'm done, he finally gets up. It's probably more than an hour. And so I'm thinking, I go, yo. Dude comes to the gate, because we had a gate that separated us, and he's like, what's up? And I was like, what were you doing? He said, praying. And in my head, I said to the dude, you said that many Our Fathers? Like, yo, you know, because I Catholic background. I'm like, you prayed Our Father for an hour? I'm like, dang, that's a lot. He's like, no, I was talking to God. He said, if I'm here, it's for you. So I had to be prepared.
Yeah.
And I said, well, what you doing here anyway? He said, I'm innocent. He said, at this time, big shout out, if you're out there and you hear the story and it resonates and it's you, call the number. You know, but the reality is that this dude, he told me that his wife was on drugs. Well, his ex-wife was on drugs. They started arguing. The neighbors called the cops. She threw the pipe in the car. And so he gets arrested also, thinking that it's drugs. But he said, I'm innocent. He said, I'm a pastor now.
Yeah.
She's the one with the problem. And so I kind of was like, I kind of believed him, because, yeah, he started, but I still wasn't sure, you know, because I didn't know how this worked. And, you know, in the streets, you look at everybody like,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know? And so this dude, all of a sudden, man, he goes, I wind up getting moved to the trustees. I become the head of the kitchen. And all of a sudden, I told the CEO, it was the first time I would ask permission, you know?
Yeah.
And so I'm like, yo, I want to bring this dude food. And I go to bring him food. Months later, this dude's discipling me. He's, you know, all this stuff. I'm in the cell. There's no worship team. There's no piano. There's nobody talking to me. It just what the guy had said to me impacted me. And I wanted to change, man. I had 25 years. I was facing 25 years.
Yeah.
For possession of methamphetamine, over 400 to 200 on an aggravated robbery charge that I really didn't do. So they dropped that one, and the other one, you know, yeah, kicks on. And I was on the cell, and I opened up the Bible and I started reading it. And it's like the book of, I remember the book I read, it was the book of Proverbs, you know, Proverbs. Then I went to like Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And for the first time in my life, that made sense to me. Like it opened, like, I don't know, I just got open. I just started like reading it, and it made sense to me. I was like, yo, this is crazy. But I was hearing it the way, you know, God was speaking to me through his word,
yeah,
from a street way, I guess. You know, I understood it. I was like, I understand this, you, yeah, know. You start reading, I run out the next day, I told the dude, yo, I was like, this is crazy, you know. This is so good. It makes sense. Like, now I know, you know, why. It's like I had my own altar call. I know why. I know why. I know why I did this. And so, you know, I'm excited. And the dude looks at me and he's like, no, take your time.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's like that first Snickers that you got in commissary, you know? He's like, take a bite of it and just chew on it, man. He said, just chew on it. Just feel every piece of that Snickers, you know? So he said, because sheep has four stomachs. It digests piece by piece. You just chew on it. And when I went to bring him that food, let me reverse a little bit. When I went to bring him the food, the guy wasn't there. He was innocent. And so my life changed forevermore, you know? Jonah got spit out of the mouth of the whale. I got spit out of the mouth of the jail.
Yeah.
You with me? And I haven't stopped. Like, to me, it's that real to me. You know, it's not like, oh, I go to church because I have to. I get to.
Yeah.
I don't read my Bible because I have to. I get to. It's just real to me. You know, it's crazy because as much crazy stuff as we saw in the streets, we got to believe that there's a devil. And so if I always tell people, man, my wife doesn't know that life. So when we drive in the car, sometimes I take her back to that life. I go simultaneously, babe, at the same time. There's somebody in the car right now who's about to get robbed. This other lady's about to get tricked. This other person, this. And she's like, what? I'm like, yeah, right now when we're driving on 45 in this highway, it's exactly what's happening at the same time.
Yeah.
And that's so diabolical. How can you not believe that there's a God? You with me? Sometimes because of the way it was represented to us. But to me, I have tasted and seen that it is good, man, and it's all good. Mm. So how can I go back?
Preach.
You know what I'm saying? How can I go back? But I mean, you got cats like that cat right there. You know, it's because they don't. I love talking truth, but I love keeping it real, and I love reading in context and all that. And even that cat that was talking, you know, I'm not gonna give him glory, so I'm not gonna mention his name. But the reality is that this cat's talking all this stuff, and he's hitting me with our stuff, and I was like, if I'm a fisher of men, who am I supposed to be hanging out with?
Yeah.
And I said, there's stories in the Bible. I said, there wasn't only two lost in the prodigal son. There was the lost one who was the wayward son. That's us. We went out and spent it all and tripped out.
Yeah.
And we came to our senses and we come to the Lord. I said, but there was another one. The other one was just as lost, and the other one was in the Father's house, and he knew God. He read the Bible. He knew everything. He had the button-up shirt and the jacket. He went to everything. He prayed. He did all the good stuff, but he missed it because he wasn't excited that Jesus was sitting with the lost. And so some people are out there and they don't get excited when we're sitting with people that they don't have no understanding of what God is doing in their life. And they judge you based upon what they know about Lucky and what Lucky's been through, but they don't know what Lucky's going through and where he's trying to come out of. Or anybody else, right? Like the Kanye thing. Everybody like, oh, Kanye, he ain't real. He ain't, shut up. You ain't thinking that about the guy in the third row that raised his hand last Sunday just because he got no name. You didn't go like, he ain't real. No, you hugged that dude and you were like, yo, welcome to the church. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So how could you, like, just because all of a sudden these people, it's harder when you have like
background, like, that everybody knows.
Yes. Yeah, because at the same time when we talking and we're like, da 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 da, yo, let me tell you something real openly. I hit you in a place where I was like, look, this is what God is saying, and we're not going to put it out there, but it was our own private conversation, right? Me, him, and his wife, Kelly. And I gave you real, and you never once bucked the system. You received it. You stood there. You gave me the eye like you're giving me right now, and you just took it. Yeah. And you were like, all right, bet, da-da-da-da-da, right? So how in the whole planet going to talk out of an Instagram photo? You temporary person. You know what I mean? Like, you can't judge something based on a glimpse.
Temporary person. That's a good one. That's a good one.
You know, like, off of a glimpse, like, how you going to do that? You know, I always wonder, you know, Jesus was hanging out with Nicodemus, and they went at night, and he was teaching them, and he was a Pharisee. If he would have been blown up on Instagram talking about, look at Jesus, it's midnight, he hanging out with this dude. Like, come on, oh, he over there with Mary, she used the trick. Yeah. No, but I mean, right? Because he talked to the prostitute.
That's what they say, he hung with criminals.
Yeah, he hung with criminals. Now, and the crazy part is he sat with them and gave them truth. Now, he hung out with the disciples. Those were his crew. But he always took the time to sit down and break down something for people.
Yeah.
And then it was up to the people to receive it. So, for me, I went deep sea fishing for the first... I only fished one time in my life. And last year, this dude, he took me out all the way to Alaska. We went to Alaska. So I fished one time. All the fishermen in Houston, they're like, they ruined you because now you can't fish nowhere else.
Yeah.
So they took me. Boom. I got this pole. You know what I'm saying? All these cats around me. And so all of a sudden, oh, you throw this you big old hunk of meat on it. You throw it in the thing. I'm like, what are we going to catch with that? You know what I'm saying? The shark, you know? Yeah. And so boom, it starts pulling. And you start pulling that thing up, right? And to me, all those guys, people who are fishermen, you're going to go after the big fish, right? So realistically, you put that thing and you start, the problem with the big fish is that they fight back.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's a fight, yo. Yeah. You just can't catch the big fish. Catching Lucky on that thing, you can't just go out there with a little worm. You gotta go out there high. And you gotta spend time. You gotta sweat. You gotta walk with it. And you gotta talk with it. You gotta build a relationship. It ain't just boom, I put my hand on your forehead, you start spinning around, shining behind up, flip backwards, and you good. Yeah. No, it takes some intentional time. How could we think of it different? When we was on the block, you just didn't give a brick to somebody. You gave him a little something. See if he came back. Give him a little something. Then you got the ones that are like, yo, man, you never guess what happened.
Yeah.
You don't give him more.
Yeah.
And that took time. That took time until you build up. So all of a sudden, we come the opposite way. We think it's going to be different. It's the same thing. But when you get that, when you get that big fish, man, and they hit him in the head with a mallet, pow! Your wife's like, let me hit him in the head. She had that look right now. She's like, give me the mallet. and that fish, man, it's the best moment in the planet.
Yeah.
It's the best moment in the planet because that fish, realistically, is beautiful.
Yeah.
That big fish, they want to mount it, man, because it's beautiful. That's what you are, bro.
Yeah.
You a big fish out there. God's looking at you going, when I get this dude right here, you're going to change the world. When I get this dude right here, they're going to change the world. Mm-hmm. There's nothing, everything I did that I thought I did good, he gave me that gift.
Yeah.
When I flipped it and started using it, you know, I did the flip. I started flipping cities instead of flipping bags, you know what I'm saying? And before you know it, like, I'm blessed. My life is really blessed. Like, I'm good.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's amazing, man. And so, big shout out to you for still putting out there your faith, putting your family out there. I salute you for that. And don't let any of these people who aren't representing Jesus right to tell you any different.
Yeah.
Because in reality, that's a big thing.
Yeah, yeah. And I knew your story was powerful, and I knew we had a platform, and I knew it had to be heard. And, you know, we're about, on this channel, New Channel TV, they know we're about positive vibes, and they know we're trying to live right, and you know, we ain't into the negative lifestyle that we been in, so I thought you'd be the perfect guest for this podcast.
I'm excited, man. I'm excited. I like cats, you know, that keep it real.
Yeah.
I do. I mean, you know, I wholeheartedly feel that you got to keep, you know, nobody wants, everybody wants authenticity. You with me? Ain't nobody want, you want Nikes, you don't want Mikeys. You want Gucci, not Mucci. So realistically, we know that people are, like, if you're going to get your wife your bag, she want the real deal, you know what I'm saying? She don't want like something like, she'll take it, but she's like, all right, babe, come on. Like, come on. Well, because we're authentic. Realistically, there's something inside of us that wants that authenticity. We want that real.
Yeah.
So we can't keep giving a lie and expecting the people to come out of slavery.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like I see like a lot of times, and I was talking to you about this the other day, when I see like my black brothers and stuff, man, I see so many of them coming out with businesses and movies, and I mean, Tyler Perry's killing it, right? I mean, killing it. You look at BET, that dude's giving people, I watched the Fall From Grace the other day with Tyler Perry, and that dude was giving jobs to the lady from the Huxtables and all that. He's pulling them all, giving Whoopi Goldberg jobs, giving them all jobs.
Yeah.
And us, it's so like, we still wanna be in the block. Like, why you still wanna be on the block? When you have wisdom, you have talent, you have smart. Look, the reason you're successful in that is because you have a gift.
Mm-hmm.
So use that gift and create some revenue positively so nobody can take it from you.
Yeah.
Now we're talking, and now we can change the hood and everything, man.
Yeah, I don't think that we as Latinos have enough positive people that are high, that come from that street background. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We have like politicians, Latin politicians and people up there, but they kind of were always book smart and played by the rules. And we don't have enough people that came from like our background that
are
to the top that can still, that people can say, oh, okay, I know they came from where I'm at right now. And if they could do it, I could do it.
Yeah. You know, I tell people it's funny because, you know, for some reason, I think God got a sense of humor. And I don't know why yet when I get up there, I'm going to ask him. You know, I'm gonna be like, yo, boy, you crazy, you know? But the reality is that, man, I started reading like at 30-something years old. I'm 48 going on 49, right?
Yeah.
I started reading in my 30s. I need you to think about this. Locked up, I started reading, right? Mm. And so I get out, and so boom, all of a sudden, you know, we start this Bible study. It grows. We're like, oh, man, I call somebody. I'm like, yo, I think I'm a pastor, you know? I'm like, they're like, what? I'm like, people keep coming. They want more. Now I was studious. I studied a lot. You know, I spent a lot of time with the Lord. So, and then I went to school. You know, at a late age, I was like the old dude and the young, and the, you know, because I'm like, I'm going to go to college. You know, it's not, I'm not only going to do this stuff when I get, I start working out tomorrow. Come on, baby. I see you out there drinking your coffee, running. I'm about to start working out. I'm about to blow up. And so, you know what I'm saying? And so I feel like I don't want to just do that when I'm locked up. I want to do that stuff now.
Exactly.
You with me?
That's what I say. I said that on one of my videos, that a lot of times when dudes get locked up, they start reading, they get closer to God, and they start exercising.
Yeah.
But I was telling people, they could take them same principles and live on them out here, that they can get anything they want if they just stay disciplined and did that every single day. Not just once a week, twice a week, but every day. Like if you were locked up and that's all you had, and you had to do it every day.
Well, and that's how you become that, you know, in everything. You know, dieting, everything. Dieting is hard, budgeting is hard, anything that you have to like
It takes discipline.
Yeah, it takes discipline, but that takes you doing it enough times. Like, ain't nobody struggling brushing their teeth. I hope ain't nobody out there, you know, because you've done it so much that you know how to brush. But in the beginning, somebody was on you.
Brush your teeth.
Brush your teeth, you know, brush your tongue. You know, here's the truth. When you were a kid, they're like, yo, you put your shoes on back, or put it right, over and over and over and over. Now we're putting on shoes, you know what I'm saying, while talking on the phone and brushing our teeth, you know? You know, we got it. And it's the same concept. Like, for me, I tell cats all the time, I say, don't think, because I got this extensive library, I go, don't think that you look at me and like, I enjoy reading now, but even me enjoying it, I'm like a lawnmower. You know, I open the book and I'm like, Father, help me with this book, you know, and then it's like, but once I kind of get in, I'm in. And the more I do it, the more I hunger for it, you know? So I think a lot of times we don't give ourselves enough time. Like, we want to do something for 2 weeks and expect to change.
Right. Mm.
Like, nah, you got to do it for a little bit. And if you can't, because you're not strong enough, you need to find somebody, you know, mentor, coach, somebody that's willing to walk alongside you and put up with your hard-headed behind and just walk with you, man, so that every time you want to get off of it, they're like, nah. You know, I got my son working out with me. You know, he's a bodybuilder. He ain't giving me no breaks. He's like, tomorrow we start leg day. I'm like, great. You know?
Yeah.
And so I feel like sometimes we need that person, but we're so prideful in the Hispanic community that sometimes we don't want nobody telling us what to do. But if you knew what you was going to do, you would be doing it.
Yeah. And that's a really good point, because like you said, that's like one of the things that we've been preaching, and I commend you for that
good.
Because like, y'all have seen him doing it, like, from the beginning, you know. It just, he started doing it, he started reading, he had these goals at the you know, at the beginning of the year. And we spoke about this on the podcast, remember? Mm-hmm. We had like our little goal talk. And so he put it out there that he was gonna start, you know,
it's March 1st and I still ain't fell off of
being more what was the word?
That
disciplined. Yeah. But he was gonna improve in himself. Like, he was
self-improved.
And he's been doing it, and he's not just preaching to y'all, you know. It's hard to do it whenever people are just in your face telling you, oh, this is what you gotta do, this is what you gotta do. But like he said, sometimes you need that mentor to bring you back and be like, yeah, it's hard, but
you can do it.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's March. It's funny you say that, because right now, usually everybody that started, so I commend you on that too.
Yeah,
because in March, right here, hey, let me tell you something. January, boom, they will change everything.
You know, and I think it has to do with me recording myself and putting it out there, because maybe if I didn't do it on YouTube for the whole world to see, then I probably would have fell off.
Oh, sure. No, but he's quick to put the camera on me like, she's eating a taco.
Yeah, but because I know I got these viewers watching me, and they waiting to see me fall off.
I need y'all to know.
They're fuming you.
Yeah, so I'm like, I gotta show him. I gotta do it.
Yeah, and he's always I need y'all to know that she's tempting me right now. She's being the devil right now.
Hey, man, let me tell you, because in March, usually people fall off. Then springtime come. Then the summer come, you start partying, start eating, all that stuff. Then before you know it, it's the holidays, so you Thanksgiving again. Now you fell off all all the way until January again. Mm-hmm. So this is the time where you should encourage your people that this, like, make March your January. Like if you're starting again, like, yeah, keep going. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Because people start falling off in everything. They get income tax, they forgot. They get income tax. Yeah, you don't see them at church. You see them in the videos eating. You know, they were crying because they didn't have no money. Now they bought everything overpriced. It's crazy, man. I trip out. I'm like, yo, people are nuts.
Yeah. Another crazy thing we were talking about before you got here is when we first started this podcast, we told ourselves we weren't going to talk about religion or politicians or none of that. And look at us now.
Hey, you know what's crazy? I mean, the crazy part is that, look, when something is good, you got to share it.
Yeah.
You can't get to the point, like, it's not like, this is an open podcast. So next week, you could, like, if we talk about leadership or, like, we talk about growing, right? Like, so you know that a rubber band is called to live on the stretch. In other words, like, a rubber band that's not stretched is not holding nothing together.
Yeah.
And so in life, there's the same thing. So we just, it's funny because in the beginning, they used to tell me, my kids, like, oh, you know, Pops, you know, we're going to give another sermon. And I was like, look, if I was an engineer giving you advice, you wouldn't say that to me. You with me? And I think a lot of times we get skeptical about sharing what we believe in because people are going to start saying, oh, he got religious. No, he didn't get religious. His eyes is open.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? His eyes is open. He could see. You'd want him to share something about banking if all of a sudden he got rich. You wouldn't want him to stop saying that. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Of course. So it's the same concept. We're going to talk about what we have in our heart.
And like what we're going through.
What we're going through.
And this is just what we're going through.
Yeah.
And I think by me praying every day, every morning, like I started at the beginning of this year, it's not something I did all last year. I wasn't doing. Maybe that's why we said we were going to talk about religion last year, because I wasn't on religion last year.
Yeah, you weren't on. Yeah.
I was on something else. But the start of this year, you know what I'm saying? I started praying and everything, and people started coming into my life, though. Like you.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's crazy.
I believe God's sending people into my life to help me and keep me accountable for what I'm doing. You know what I'm saying? It's crazy.
That's what's up. And then you're having another baby.
Yeah,
right?
So I can't afford to be out messing up like I was, you know what I'm saying? And
one
little drink will lead to... So I was at the studio yesterday, and everybody in there, it was every vice you could think of.
I was so scared.
The day before, I told you that the day before. I was already stressed out because the kids were fighting, giving me a hard time, and I even told her, dang, right now I feel like I need a glass of wine or something, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, the pressure,
What did I tell you? That's just going to make you break out. And you still broke out.
So anyway, I go to the studio the next day, and man,
just the thought of it.
Everything was up in that studio. That's probably why I broke out of smoke up in that studio.
Yeah.
Man, there was smoking in there. There was pills, drink, cigarettes, weed, everything you could think of, man, that was going on in that studio. And before, you know what I'm saying, I would have engaged with all that.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
I would have been with everybody
in there was doing it, and I would have been right there with them. Getting high, drinking, doing everything, but I just, you know what I'm saying? It was hard, but I just said, I can't do it, you know what I'm saying? Every time they would pass it to me, I said, no, I'm good, and I just took care of my business, went in the booth, did what I do, and I left, you know what I'm saying? And I felt good when I left that I was able to leave sober still, and you know what I'm saying? I denied that temptation.
Look, Coast proud of you right now.
Yeah,
he's looking at you, he's giving you that eye.
Because Coast knows how I was, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I was the one turning up.
I was just about to ask you, Coast.
Like, the Lucky I remember, he would have been the one that brought that to the studio. studio session would have just been, you know, like, calm, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Not even, I'm talking about before Lucky gets there, the studio session would have just been chill. We got the person recording or whatever.
Normal studio session.
Lucky come busting the door, who want this and that and that? And then it's just all
from there.
Into the nighttime hours. And then, so to hear him say, you know, that he fought all of that temptation.
So you've been with him for a hot minute.
Yeah, like 20 years.
Yeah, about 20 years.
Hey, so let me hear it, right? So you respect him for that, being that kind of person, right? Because a lot of times cats try to pull you back when you start making decisions like that, right? But you had that look on your face like you was proud of him, you know? You had that look on your face like you respected him and you know him for that long, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, well, I just carry so much respect for Lucky anyways, just because out of the 20 years, you know, we done traveled the country who knows how many times back and forth, you know, so we already have that kind of camaraderie, you know,
that's
that,
cool,
that relationship, that friendship. Me personally, I was never really too deep into all of that nonsense, you know what I'm saying? So to see somebody that was, but that was around the entire time, to see him grow out of that, I'm like, dog, finally.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
So you're having your own little celebration inside. You're like, yes.
Yeah.
That's what's up. Because obviously you see like there's more in them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's a good thing. I think that's good because a lot of times you said it the other day, right? You
well,
say
that's when you feel you find out who your real friends are.
Yeah. They're like, oh, what you mean, man? It's almost like they want to twist your arm and you're like, yo, you can't respect the fact that I said no.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I think a lot of times, you know, people should respect that no. It doesn't mean like I got corny. It just means that I don't want to do that no more. I'd rather put my money somewhere else. I'd rather spend my time with my family. Like, there's different decisions to those decisions, you know?
Mm-hmm. And I do want to say, Coast, to you, I like, thank you for respecting that. Because I know that there's some friends that you have that even if I tell them, like, hey, you know, he's trying to, like,
try to chill.
Yeah, and they like just come and they keep insisting it and they're like rubbing it in his face and I'm just like, dude. And then next thing you know, like he just falls into it and I'm just like, and it's not that I don't like the friends, it's I know that he's grown and he can make his own decisions, but thank you for, you know, taking that into consideration because Coast has became like family. I mean, he's been here for Christmas. He, you know, we invite him all the time.
I mean, he's on the wall. You know what I'm saying? He's on the wall, man. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but he shows our kids love. And you know, we invited you to be on part of the podcast. And here we are. Look at us. Seventh episode. Yeah. What?
And it don't feel weird either. It's like I'm... Now that I can be cool with Luggy the way I felt like we always should have been cool.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like maybe back then he was just a different person.
Sure.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. But now that he's not that person no more, it's like we connect. I'm over here all the time. Me and his family, we all cool. It's all love.
Yeah.
And so now...
Well, he was under the... When you're under the influence of something else, whatever you're under the influence is what's going to control you. You follow me? Yeah. So it ain't really that the people... are bad, they're just influenced by what, if you're drinking Jack Daniels, you're influenced by the Jack Daniels, you know, you're drinking, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, that's the only difference, like, you know, we're influenced now by a different spirit, not that kind of spirit, you know? So, I mean, I think it's all live. I think it's cool when friends could accept, like, to me, that's a man. So it ain't like, a man is one that could accept, I can be around you and I can accept you for who you are and what decisions you're making. You with me? Like, I don't think, like, we gotta be like, oh, we only boys if we turn up. I think we go from, you know, you're the boys to men, you know? Yeah. Like, we gotta, sometimes you gotta mature up. Like, I got friends of mine back home that I have went home, and when I went, they invited me to this place, and when I got there, I felt like I was in high school.
Yeah, that same.
I'm like, these cats are still doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. I'm like, that's crazy.
It's crazy that you say that, because I have no friends. Like, I literally have no friends, and I feel like it's because of that, because they're still doing the same thing, and if I was still turning up with them, if I was still out here doing that, they'd probably still be, you know what I'm saying, be on the ground, posting pictures, making videos.
It's crazy, like, man.
But like now, you don't even get a text message from these people.
And you kind of stay stuck when you get high and you drink and all that. Like, you get stuck at the age that you did it. That's why we act real immature when we was. You know, you kind of stay stuck. Like you, when you party and you still you acting like a baby, basically. You know, and so you know. Big shout out to all the people out there, man, that stand their ground, you know? So I give you a salute for that too, you know?
Thank you.
The fact that you stand your ground and you're openly known.
Yeah.
So it's not like you're hiding, you know, because it's not like you're like that one way and then you go in there and you're like, well, I'm in the studio, so let me act another way.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, that's
like you're
what
trying
I'm
to
saying.
Keep it. You said trill, right? They say trill, keep it trill.
Yeah, keep it trill.
you're going over there and this is what I stand for. And that's what's up.
Yeah, I'm still the same. It's the same me. When y'all see me on the blogs of my family, when I show up to the studio and everybody turn up, I'm still that same person that y'all see on the blog of my family. I'm not switching up and let me turn up because I'm with the boys now. Yeah. I'm still that same person.
Eventually, you're going to have that heart-to-heart talk. Like, yo, let's sit down like at the table. Let's talk, you know? Like, y'all going to have to stop. Not doing what they're doing because they're their own men, but like stop pushing stuff on me, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, I mean, you know, because
I don't think they're pushing out on me, and they know, I mean, I'm like OG, I'm Uncle Luck, they, you know what I'm saying? They know they're not gonna
It's true. Yeah. They didn't be like, Tia.
Yeah, no.
I'm like, nigga.
But they're gonna offer me out of like out of respect. At the same time, I'm overlooked, so they gotta share with me if that, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So they like, yo, you want some? And I'm no, okay, cool. You know what I'm saying?
They leave it alone.
Yeah, they leave
That's
it alone.
That's what's up. That's
but
what's
I
up.
Do have some friends that'll be like, come on, man.
I know it. They always out there.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. Those cats, you know, they always out. They're gonna be out there because there's a lot of times that people, you know, you hear the saying, misery loves company. You know, so they doing their thing and they ain't really happy either. So they need somebody else to be right along with them. You know, when you go to the bar and everybody drinking, everybody just tore up, everybody just drowning away everything. You know, they're like, they want you to come join this party, you know?
Yeah.
But it's good. Y'all rocking it, man. Y'all rocking it. For like all the kids and the lifestyle you're coming out of and all this stuff and just hearing y'all story. Man, y'all killing it.
Yeah. Yeah, we're trying to do the right thing, man. We're trying to do the right thing. We can't afford to take no losses.
Yeah, so for anybody out there listening right now, Stay True Sunday podcast, you heard it from Juan. I don't want to call you Pastor Juan because he said I'm Juan.
No, cool. Yeah, right here we could be Juan.
But
you know,
so look, he came out of it. He was drug dealing. He was in prison. Mm-hmm. He did it all. You know what I'm saying? Lucky, y'all know him. He's like a rapper. Y'all know him as the rapper that throwing money in the club and doing this and that. And then Coast, you know, he comes in the same environment. Me, I live that life as well. And we're sitting here and we're not trying to preach to y'all, but we're just like talking to y'all. We're an example
and showing y'all that we made it out of that lifestyle. And it's not easy,
it's
but
not
if you want to make
man.
A change, it takes some self-discipline. You really got to look at yourself in the mirror and maybe go deep inside of yourself and ask yourself, is this the life I really want to live, or do I want something better for myself?
Man, it's a daily struggle, man. We can all sit here and tell you
every day
still gonna have hard days, bad days, you know what I'm saying? Like, you just can't, like, today my website got hacked 2 days ago.
He's
two
still
flat.
Talking about the website.
That's really upsetting.
Let us talk to y'all a little bit about the website. So, Lucci Gang, if y'all are looking to buy some merch or whatever the situation is, y'all trying to get on the website, for some reason, our damn website got hacked.
We will be back, so just hold on.
Give us a second. So, this is, like, the first time that we're, like, putting it out there. We haven't vlogged this weekend, but we are going to let y'all know on the vlog. So the website got hacked, but if you go to what, luchannel.tv.com/collections,
it's, you can still get into the store.
The main page, luchannel.tv.com, is like redirecting you somewhere, but if you put luchannel.tv.com/collections, you can still go get some merch. But I didn't want to put it out there because Lucky was upset. He was like, man, that hacked my website. And we had just left church and we got this damn call.
Right when I left church.
So I was just like, I was like,
man, it gets hard when you're trying to do the right thing, right?
Oh, yeah, that's it, though. But doing the right, when you're doing the right thing, it's worth it.
Yeah.
It's worth it. It's always worth it, man. You know, it's worth it. It's like going to the gym. When I talk to like married couples and they're going through the thing, I always go like, look, just imagine you 600 pounds. Right? I said, your marriage is 600 pounds and the goal is to get it to what? And they're like, I said, what's the proper weight? She's like, well, 180, you know, whatever. Let's say 190, you know? I said, all right, that means we got to drop you from 600 to that. So what do we got to do? We got to change your diet plan, right? We got to get you on some exercises, right? So that you can get to that thing. It's the same concept. In life, it's the same concept. And the crazy part is that the first couple months, right, we go to the mirror, we start looking,
ain't nothing there,
man. It's nothing there. You know what I'm saying? There is nothing there, bro. You go again, nothing there. And sometimes what we do is we opt out. So we, the hell with this. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm going to go back to, you got to stick with it. You got to stick with it. And you keep hitting anything you stay consistent. You keep hitting this. You see, sometimes we want to hit 5 trees. And you go over here to this tree and that tree and that tree and that tree, and then nothing ever falls. But if you stay with that one tree and you keep hitting it, eventually, you know, you got one ab, two abs, before you know it, but bam, you're out there, you're looking good. Or your business or whatever it is, you got to keep hitting that same tree. You ain't going to see nothing. You're not going to see nothing until later. You got to wait. You got to get. Listen, it took a lot of times. I tell people when they're tripping, I say, how old are you? They go, 30-something. I go, it took you 30-something years to get where you at. You got to give it a little longer than a couple months. You know, you got to give it a couple years so you can really say it didn't work. You know what I'm saying? And I just believe that people could do everything and anything. And there's a real enemy out there who's trying to stop everybody. And the reality is that a lot of times that enemy ain't even the devil. That enemy is yourself. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes it's you, right? I mean, we do little things, man, that put a stop in us. For me, I don't know. I'm living, like, I don't have to worry about looking over the... You know, I see a cop, and yeah. You know it's serious when you wave at a cop. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, yo, what's up? In my neighborhood, at first I used to feel weird. Now I feel good. I'm like, yo, what? I love it, man. I love it. I don't really have to worry like that. I don't have to worry about my kids in my house. I don't have to worry about no gunplay or somebody getting shot. I don't have to worry about any of that, according to my life. Now, of course, it's out there, and sometimes we do stuff in hoods and stuff like that can happen, but not in my house and not my environment. Like, ain't nobody gonna come into my house that I hang out with that I gotta worry about. Can I leave my wallet there? You know what I'm saying? And that's that alone, that brings peace, man.
Peace of mind.
Yeah, I'm gonna make it home tonight. Like, I'm not gonna wrap my car around something. Like, I like that. I like that stuff, you know? Yeah. Now, in the beginning, it was weird. You know, I would see a cop and I freak out. I didn't even have no drugs. I just freak out because I saw the cop. I'm like, yo, I freak out. You know, everything was different to me. Like, really conversating with my wife, you know? Like, having conversations with my wife, that was abnormal to me. Because usually, if something went down, we just cuss each other out, go drink or break something, and boom. Best part of breaking up is when you're making up. You know, now it's different. Now we communicate, we talk. Things just change, man. And this is so good.
Yeah.
You know, it's so good, man. So, again, I keep saying shout out to you because, again,
it just takes time.
It takes time. And don't judge people based upon the moment. You know, that's huge. They're like, oh, well, nah, I saw him the other day. Like, shut up. Like, realistically, like, it just bothers me. It just bothers me.
Temporary person.
Yeah, you temp. You know, temp. You know, I feel like these people don't even know these people. Like, when they're like, yo, you answer, like, you know, I answered. I usually don't, but I kind of got a little, I felt like I was like, yo, what
no,
you talking
you
about?
Didn't.
Oh, I sure did. I usually leave it alone. I don't even, like, but this time I felt, I said, you know what? And then, you know, my daughter goes, just don't say nothing that you're going to insert foot. And I was like, I'm not. I'm cool. I've grown. But I'm like, yo, you're not in the room. You can't judge a person based upon a picture. You don't know what they... Like, I think it was last year, the year before, I was in Miami. And so I know cats that, you know, Fat Joe and them used to be kick door. You know, they kick doors. Like, they didn't really, like, hustle on the block. They robbed drug dealers, right? Him, Big Pun, all those cats, right?
Terror Squad.
Yeah, Terror Squad. Now everybody knows me as Pastor Juan, so they don't know that side of me. They don't know me in Roseland, Studio 54. They don't know me with the big fat rope chain. They don't know any of that. So the reality is they only know this guy, right? So then all of a sudden, I'm out this thing, this big thing, and boom, we catch each other in the bathroom. So we start talking. Before you know it, I start hitting him. Bah, bah, bah. I hit him with some word. He and there. First, we talked about Junito, a couple cats back in the day. And then I just started talking about my life with Christ, right? In the bathroom. So a couple cats started gathering around. I had my own little church service in the bathroom. Before you know it, I was like, yo, you know, can I pray for you? So I grab his hand. You know, we start praying. You know, and I go in, too, like, Father, you know, that, you know, I got... get all fired up, you know. You know, I was like, give it to him, you know. I'm like, Lord, now I respect the man, you know, he's his own man, but again, nobody was in that thing. And the minute I posted a picture, they start look, holding hands with the devil, this and that. And I'm like, I'm in the bathroom praying, all this stuff. And so there's so many people that do that.
Yeah.
And that's what messes up Christianity. You know what I'm saying? Because it's almost like, well, people are gonna, like, you're gonna go moment by moment. Like, I might not be where I'm at today and next year. Like, like, you can't go off of when I'm five. You can't judge a 1-year-old, a 2-year-old, a 3-year-old, right? You got a little later. So we don't do that with Christianity. And it's the same thing. When cats are growing and you're growing along, don't judge him because he had an off month or an off year, or maybe he's learning. You know, maybe, you know, like Kanye, he's still cussing a little. They're like, yo, Kanye, I'm like, the dude just got saved. Yeah. Like, he just got saved. What do you want him to do? Be a theologian? And like, no, he's going to still have a lot of what he is until he keeps growing. And, you know, God, obviously he disappeared for a little bit, so people are pouring into him. He's meeting pastors, all this stuff. In time, he's going to change. Your money and time is going to change. Everything is going to change according to what you put yourself around, because your friends are a prophecy of your future. Preach. Right? You know what I'm saying? And I don't know, man. I just had this thing. So, yeah, I went at the dude. And so I was like, yo, I kind of got defensive because I'm like, yo, I just
beat me on 45.
I did. I almost wanted, like, look, why don't we, you know, we can talk about this at the podcast. Meet us at the podcast, you know? But But now I'm like, you know what? Yeah, I'm like, yo, the Bible says lay hands on the sick, and you're sick, brother. You know, but the reality is that I just feel like you're doing a great job, and keep doing what you're doing, man, because, you know, there's only one person that wants you to stop doing what you're doing, and that ain't God.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I see your wife, she over there, like, cheering you on. You know what I'm saying? I see Coast, little by little, like I like Coast. You know what I'm saying? Because every time I look at that picture up there and I look down, you know what I'm saying? Word up. I'm telling you. My man, Coast,
he's talking about the picture on the Timeless album. Yeah, Timeless
album. And I'm telling you, like, this is my first time ever seeing it. And I looked up there and I said, yo, that looked like the Fast and the Furious movie. I was like, yo, these cats, you know what I'm saying? And so, man, it's just exciting to meet people like y'all, man. Yeah, y'all great people. You know, y'all great people. And it sucks that, I guess, I know I'm on this little rant. I'm on a rant right now.
Nah, I feel you, man, because when I've been trying to do my positive motivational speeches, yeah, people, I get haters and negative comments, too, because they think that I'm still the same person I was 5 years ago. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not.
No,
obviously. Every day I'm changing. I'm growing every day.
Mm. Yeah. It's not like we're in here blowing right now. You're like, right. Yo, you know what I'm saying? Let's talk about God. Like, realistically, we're having a great conversation, and you sober. You've been sober.
Yeah.
You've been praying. Your wife, you can tell.
I really do believe that's why you're here right now, because I've been praying on my knees every morning. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Like, every morning for the last, since January 1st.
You can tell. Like, you can always tell how a man doing when you look at the wife. You know what I'm saying? Because if she would have been right now, like, with the dog lip.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, right. No, you
know? And she's not. She's happy here. She's happy at church. She was happy at the restaurant. You know, so you could tell. Yeah, yeah. She was like,
I wouldn't be able to keep my house in order if I didn't pray. I knew I would not be able to do
this.
I thought
you were about to say, without her.
I would only be able to get this far without prayer because of Kelly.
Without
Kelly, I'd really be lost.
We all need the red.
Say it again.
But I feel like to keep us all in harmonious.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. To keep us all together.
Just having kids. Yeah. Hey, we ain't even talking drugs. Just having all those kids you got.
It's hard. You know what I'm saying? And just to keep my sanity, I need to pray. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what's up, man. And so I see you, man. You got entrepreneurship and all that in you, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe there's businesses coming out of this and all kinds of stuff.
Yeah,
there is. Hopefully. We claiming it. Come we manifesting
it. I'm trying to be the next motivational speaker, man.
Come on, watch out. Hey.
I'm trying to lead that old route. I don't want to be in nightclubs doing shows and everybody's drinking and smoking. I'm not trying to be in that atmosphere, you know what I'm saying? Because that atmosphere will lead me right back to where I came from. So
that's a
I'm
fact.
Not trying to be in them. Little hole in the wall clubs doing these little shows for these little bit of people for a little bit of money. I'm trying to be in these big auditoriums and motivating them and telling them where I came from and how they could do it too.
Man, hey, he's doing it now. Hey, hold on. Right now, I was about to start crying, lift my hand. Come on.
Your accent got me wanting to talk like that's a fact. Do it. The New York accent.
Oh, man, you're right. Oh, yeah, crazy.
So, a little while ago, you were showing that picture and you said you didn't want to show everybody because you were saving it for the book.
Well, right now, I'm kind of been writing this book. You know, it's funny because it was supposed to come out last year, and you know, I went through, like, last year was crazy because, you know, I'm trying to do it the right way. I could self-publish. I wanted to do it with a publishing house. I got a couple publishing houses looking at it, but, like, every time I went there, they were like, hey, you know, you got to make this, you know, I want this more real. I want you to, because they go, we want to be in the room. They're like, they told me, they say, you telling it, but I want you, you know, show and tell. You're telling it, but I want you to show me.
Yeah.
I need you to bring me in the room. So there was a time where I was going to quit, you know, because I was like, I got in my head. I felt like the enemy was like, you ain't smart enough, you know, all kinds of stuff. I'm like, oh, man, it sucks, you know. And so literally brought me to tears, you know, because it felt like I ran this race 20 miles and I put my hands up and I finally crossed the ribbon. And then they were like, yo, we forgot to turn on the camera. Could you do it again? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's the feeling I had. I'm like, you kidding me?
Yeah.
It already took a lot for me to write this book. And now you want me to do it again?
Yeah.
So I'm in the finishing process right now of, I think next week, finish putting it together. Mm. And so we got this book. We don't have a title for it yet. But, you know, it's a parallel with The Wizard of Oz. And so, you know, Heaven and The Wizard of Oz. Because I felt like Dorothy, when she went, She went to Oz. It really wasn't about the characters in Oz, like the Tin Man and the Lion, and that those people were really her. And when she comes back, she was really fighting her own mind, and she really wanted to find herself. And sometimes we think that finding herself, you know, because she wanted to go somewhere far, far away,
right?
When there was no trouble. And the reality is that I felt like in Oz she had a lot of trouble, but in that trouble she found out who she really was, right? Because she had the monkeys and she had the Wicked Witch, you know what I'm saying? And so, I'm coming out with this book. It's going to have my story and a lot of help on how to get out of certain things, you know, because I feel like God has truly blessed me to see that there's a Chinese proverb that says, follow a man who's on his way back. And so I feel like God taught me a lot of things to kind of help. I'm passionate about marriage, leadership, you know, just a lot of things, you know. But overall, you know, baby girl, I love my wife, you know, and with all my heart. And I just sucked at everything for my whole life. You know, I was a horrible dad. You know, I'm not out here like saying like, yo, I think I'm a great dad now. But I was horrible, man. Like, I didn't see my kids. Like, some of my kids I didn't see for, like, 19 years. Mm. Like, they came, you know, to the church one day and surprised me. That's how I saw my kids. And, you know, they recorded the whole thing. We were like, oh, we're crying. And they all got saved. And, you know, we've been rolling ever since. You know what I mean? So God restored everything. And so I feel like I got this second chance at life that how could I not be the way I am with people. You follow me? Like, like that's why I look through different lens. It says those that been forgiven much love much. And so for me, I feel like I've just been forgiven of so many things. I've done everything so wrong. I've done everything. I tell my kids, like, yo, relationship wrong, drugs and alcohol wrong. If you name something, I did it wrong, man.
Yeah.
That now I feel like I have this opportunity, and so I want to tell it in a book. And that's what that's all about, you know? And so
I've been writing a book too. I want to drop it when I drop my new motivational album, just as an ebook where they can get it on my website. Not like an actual book, but like an ebook. You know,
why not a book?
Well, I just feel like I wouldn't be able to have time to get it published in time. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, brother,
I maybe will in due time, but for now.
They will. Like, yo, you can do it. Hey, you can do it.
Y'all heard it here first.
For now, I was just going to do it as an ebook. And then, you know, where they have the Audible where you can read
the audiobook.
It. So I would like record it and read it, and they can get it downloaded as a, you know, like me read
and
it.
And when is this going to be a...
Hopefully this
March
month.
11th.
March 11th.
Oh, March 11th is dropping.
I already wrote 10 chapters. Like,
is it like your life story?
Nah,
or is it...
it's like from, it starts from the time I dropped out of school to be a rapper till now. It's like 20 years in the rap game. You know what I'm saying?
20 years.
Yeah, the last 20 years of my life.
Okay.
I just started with like a dream to be a rapper, and then somewhere down the line, I lost that dream in the music business and got caught up in the fast life, and then I had to go find myself and make a full 180.
I got two questions for y'all, okay? Because you hit me with one, now I'm gonna bounce one back. I like the question thing, you know. One day I wanted to be like David Letterman or something, you know. But like so if you was talking to like a young, because there's a lot of cats out there that have been influenced maybe by the music y'all sang in the past and all that, right? That you created just as much as, like, I see some cats sometimes that I sold drugs to their peers, and it almost because of me, they're kind of there.
Yeah.
You with me?
Mm-hmm.
And so it sucks, but it is what it is, right? So now I'm trying my best at trying to influence them different, right? So if you were going to talk to somebody right now that was young, you know, 15, when you started?
Yeah, around that age.
All right, 15, and he's like, all he has is old Lucky stuff. And all that stuff,
yeah,
right?
I got young homies that are like that.
Okay, and what would you say to them, though?
Like, man, I know it looks good and it sounds good on the rap song, but when you're really living that life on a day-to-day basis, it's a lonely, hard, dark place that you don't want to be. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Even with the money and the girls or whatever, you know what I'm saying? The stuff that we glorify in these rap songs and make it sound good to the listener. And a young teenager might fall for that, and I did too.
Sure.
That's what made me want to be a rapper. But when you really living that life, that fast life, and not all rappers, but some rappers like Coast, for instance, they don't deal with that. My friend Chingo Bling, he was a successful rapper, and he never dabbled in that stuff, you know what I'm saying? So there is some rappers that can do it. But to the rapper that you're talking about that was influenced by me and the stuff I was talking about, I would say, it sounds better than what it really is, and you don't want that life.
Okay, so my question over here, Coast, is for you now. And so I don't know, when I talk to him, I'm telling you, all I see, look, he's looking at me
forward. You look so but
I
serious.
See, but I, hey, but I see this. I only see side posts. Yeah. Yeah, check it out. So I hear you say, like, when you was in that, you, and even he just said that you really weren't in that. So if you was talking to somebody, like, my thing is, how did you overcome? Like, how did you bob and weave this thing and never really jump into the things? Like, I know you can say, well, it wasn't for me, but realistically, you had to do something, like, mentally or something in your heart, you had to say something for you not to do it. How do people stay away from it? You were talking to that same 15-year-old that he's like, I hear what you're saying, but how did you do it?
Well, for me, it was easy. So like, back when I was in high school, I used to be big pothead or whatever.
Yeah.
Not because I liked it, but yeah, because it was what my boys was doing.
Right.
And at a certain point, I was like, I don't like this.
What?
Yeah. I was like, if y'all want to do it, whatever. And actually, here's $5. Let me just chill with everybody and have a good time. Just don't pass it to me.
Yeah.
And wow. It was good like that. And then later on in life, I started trying something different.
Yeah.
Some Xanax or
yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
I got into that, and I got into that pretty heavy. And I found someone at the time who was also abusing substance.
Yeah.
And we kind of clicked and told each other, I won't do it if you won't do it.
Word?
And we'll watch out for each other in that sense. And so we did.
That's what's up.
And then I just completely gave all that up. And then outside of that, I don't want to say I was straight edge. You know, I still drink every now and again. But
yeah,
for the most part, yeah, I just, it wasn't appealing to me anymore.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you just avoided it. You just said no.
Basically.
That's what's up.
Yeah.
And a lot of times with rappers, they feel like they need the drugs for creativity. Like, for instance, yesterday when I was in the studio, there were some young rappers that are talented. They went in there with no pen, no pad, and came up with a hook, like, quick. You know what I'm saying? But at the same time, they were smoking, and they had a bag full of pills, and they was eating them, you know what I'm saying? And then they would go into the booth, like, after they was on that level. You know what I'm saying? So I know what it is, because I used to be like that, and they feel like they need that to let them go into the booth and be artistic and be creative, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I get it.
And you got to be able to overcome that, because that little thing that you think that you need can turn into an addiction, and that's what happened to me, because I would do it just for creativity and be in the studio, but then somewhere down the road, I ended up becoming a straight addict, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, man.
And I lost myself in that. You know what I'm saying? And I forgot what my main goal was, and my main mission was to be a successful rapper. You know what I'm saying? And now I'm just straight trying to get high. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And that's where I messed up. And that's what the book was about.
Man, that's good stuff. And it's motivation.
Yeah.
Okay. You in that book, Kelly? You coming out? You need a book.
I haven't read it.
Well, I got a whole chapter on Kelly and how she came into my life, and how that was the beginning turning point of my life where it started to change.
I've been telling him I want to read it, but he's like, hold on.
He wants a surprise.
But so that book came about randomly, like this last week. He just told me about the book, and I was like, what?
Like I said, I've been every day. I run in the morning, I pray, and I read every day. You know what I'm saying? So I've been reading these books every day. And I was just like, man, I could write a book. I could do this. You know what I'm saying? I could write a book. Because basically these motivational books I've been reading, they're giving points and motivation. They're like giving, like basically giving game. They're giving you game. But they're also telling going back to stories in their life, what happened. You know what I'm saying? So that's what made me think, oh, I could do this too. I can just tell them the game, but then also give them stories of what happened to me. And you know what I'm saying?
And
they
could
learn from that.
There it is. The book, the legend. All the
time. But so it was random. I'm telling you, it was random for me to hear him talk about the book, because we were already working on like a launch for a motivational album together because of what he's been doing. So we're releasing that March 11th. So y'all heard it here first. Y'all haven't heard it anywhere. I literally just heard about it this last week. And we haven't told y'all this. So y'all got, you know what I'm saying?
Fresh off the press.
Yeah.
Fresh off the press.
So yeah, there should be a book coming out as well, along with the motivational album. So y'all stay tuned for that March 11th. But I think...
Is that the one that you're rapping on?
She's singing. Hey,
I'm singing. So embarrassed.
Hey, what do you mean? Hey, they got you. Hey, they brought you in.
I was laughing so hard, but yeah, that's the one we're talking about.
So how we pulled her in is because on that album, Timeless album, me and Coast, he took a clip of her talking on one of the podcasts where she was basically saying something about like being positive and how your positivity can change the environment around you. Instead of letting the environment change you, you be that light that changes the environment around you.
Hold up.
So she was saying that on the podcast, and he took that sound bite and put it on one of our songs that's on that time.
And I thought they were trying to be sneaky because they looked at each other like, that's it. That's what we needed. Yeah. And then I'm like, what are y'all talking about? And then I ended up hearing it, and I was like, damn, okay.
Okay.
So that's what gave me. I was like, man, I need to make a whole album like that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's what we did.
That's what's up. That's what's up.
Yeah. So we really appreciate you for coming. Pastor
thanks,
Juan.
Man. I appreciate that.
Again, he has a church.
Give him the address.
Get Rap Church, 23211 Aldean Westfield is over there in Spring, Texas. You can find it social media and all that. Just put Get Rap, GETWRAPPED. If you the app Get Rap TV, it's the only one in the planet. There's not another Get Rap Church. Yeah. You know, usually they're all the light of the world and all that. So we're the only Get Rap in the world. So you put Get Rap, you're gonna see two things. You're gonna see the people trying to lose weight with the rap, and you're gonna see our church. Yeah. You know, so
tell them your Instagram
JuanMartinez.tv, Facebook JuanMartinez. Check it out, man. Come check it out. You know, check it out online. Just come check it out. I'm telling you, it'll be life changing. You know, judgment free zone. We'll just point you in the right direction. You can't say like, stop judging me if you're going the opposite direction and I tell you Walmart's that way. You can't be like, stop judging me. I'm just trying to tell you which way to go, fool.
Right.
Yeah.
But the reality is that judgment free zone. You can come as you are, man.
We went to the church today, me and Kelly and the kids, and
yeah, that's what's up.
It was a good message you said. You spoke on something about other preachers that you were talking with that said the hardest thing that happened to them during their ministry was they became famous.
Yeah.
And people started looking to them to better their relationship with God, when in actuality they need to make a relationship with God themselves instead of you know what I'm saying, looking to Pastor Juan to change their life. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because the whole goal is for us to introduce you to the person that's changing our life.
Yeah.
Right, and a lot of times we don't want to have a relationship with God. We're almost like spiritual window peepers.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Like, this guy have a relationship with God. He's trying to tell you about it, so you don't want to pray. You want him to pray for you.
Yeah,
all the time, rather than having your own personal relationship. And then this helps too. You with me? But sometimes people don't want to open up the Bible. They don't want to pray. They don't want to do nothing. They just want you to do it, and then they want you to give them the answer. And that's not how it works. That's not what brings about change. So, yeah, that's what it was about.
Yeah.
That's what's up. You were preaching right now without even knowing.
Y'all don't be coming to the church trying to get an autograph from Lucky or none of that. You know, I'm trying to get a picture from him. Y'all come to get the word.
Come to get the word. That's the truth, man. And, you know, and we work at that too. Like, I think most of the cats there and most of the people of the church, like, they come from rough paths and all that too. And I wouldn't let that happen anyway. You know what I'm saying? Because that's your family time.
Yeah.
You know, that's your family. That's the time where you get to go and you get to enjoy. Hopefully we see Coast roll up.
Coast lives closer to that church than we do.
Hey, Coast right now, he like, man, I might have to chase this dude down. Like, he ain't that bad.
I might have to pop up.
Hey, you'll feel it, man. You will definitely feel it.
Man, we have to go get some lechon after that.
Hey,
said, Coach, you want to do your thing? Make sure y'all.
Make sure y'all like and subscribe, hit the bell for notifications and comment.
Have a great day.
We'll see y'all next Sunday. Appreciate y'all for watching Luciano TV. Mm-hmm.